straight away to your conclusions and the main points of your paper.
So I think this is critical.
There are other people also not present. Yes, please go.
Here, the era of globalization and increasing foreign direct investment and growing technology, you can see that business is growing more nurturing the economies of nations. But that is just a one side of the coin. The other darker side is, it is also laying on some loopholes wherein the possibility of financial fraud is also emerging a lot. So here in the scenario of emerging fraud, we come to the tool of called forensic accounting, which will be helping in curbing and mitigating financial fraud. Forensic accounting is basically made up of two components. First is litigation service and the other one is investigative skills. It is primarily an area of specialization wherein it is helpful in detection and prevention of financial fraud. It is a blend of accounting, auditing and investigative skills. And here if we just differentiate between two aspects, like how does forensic accountant differs from a traditional accountant, we get to see that as traditional accountants, they act like a watchdog to company's financial statements. Forensic accounting act like a bloodhound to financial company statements, so as to bring out true business situations so that the person who is investing, the stakeholders and other parties, they are not being victimized by just seeing the lucrative pictures being drawn by the accountants and the auditors. This concept of forensic accounting is basically 200 years old, and it was the early reference can be found in the Glasgow, Scotland. Maurice E. Palaby was the first person to coin the term called forensic accounting. In India, it is on at an absolutely embryonic stage. Nothing much has been done in this regard. Of course, the creation of SFIOs, that is Serious Fraud Investigation Offices, has been a landmark creation. Basically, in India, the work of forensic accounting is being performed by CBI officers or CID corps. As far as the literature review is concerned, the researchers are also of the view that in the scenario of emerging fraud, financial fraud, which is eating the financial health, like a termite to all the financial sectors of the economies of different nations, forensic accounting can play a very instrumental role in just detecting and preventing those frauds and the possibilities and the perpetrators of frauds, and just bring out the solutions and proper implications which would help the management of the financial sectors to make the company's financial statements more authentic and more true to the stakeholders and the other of parties which facilitates trade in them. As far as the forensic accounting is concerned, which is helpful in the mitigating fraud in financial sectors, I've chosen banking sector, which is a pivot around which whole economy clusters. And here, because due to the failure of proper internal control system or the lethargy of the governing bodies which track down the security track here, and thereby losing the public confidence in the transaction system in the bank, forensic accounting can be considered a demand of the hour to curb and mitigate those frauds. That is a statistic which shows that from the year ranging 2010 to 2012-13, number of cases of fraud and the amount which has been continuously increasing. Here are certain factors which are divided into institutional factors and environmental factors which cause, stimulate the people to commit fraud. Here are certain effects which bank would have to just, that will be a drawback to a bank if such fraud is committed in certain part of the banking operations. Firstly, it will be eruption of the public confidence in dealing with the bank. The other one is bank would lose its profitability and bank capital base. The other part is it will be eventualizing into depletion of stakeholders and of course the retrenchment of staff and the long going concept which will be hugely affected as it will be closed down for the commercial bank, and finally it will be destroying the economy of nation and sovereignty goes.
Sir?
Yes, sir. As far as the significance is concerned, it is highly, this tool for its accounting would be highly.
Significance we have already mentioned in the introductory remarks. So anything else?
That's it.
Okay. Thank you. Now the...
Lack of time, I have objectives. Objectives of the study are to explain the role and importance of financial inclusion, to highlight the measure taken by the Government of India and RBI, and to bring to light whether there is any relationship between opening the no-frill accounts and Bank of Baroda and the dependency of villages on informal source of financing. Next objective is to highlight whether there is any relationship between age and awareness about the financial services launched in the market among the users. And next is to identify whether the level of education among the customer has any relation with the saving habit. research trilogy of this paper is Bank of Baroda in Nagpur. From town literature was selected. Primary data was collected from the sample size of 200, and secondary data were collected from the website newspaper reports. And a statistical tool chi-square was used. And if the chi-square calculated value is less than the table value at 5% level of significance, then null hypothesis is accepted, otherwise rejected. And hypothesis of the study are: opening the no-frill accounts in Bank of Baroda has not helped the villages in reducing their dependence on informal source of financing. Second null hypothesis: age of the customers who opened the no-frill account and the awareness about the financial services provided in the Nagpura are not related to each other. And the third is the level of education among the customers of these facilities has no relation with the saving habit. Next, role and importance of financial inclusion in rural India. The high dependence of rural India on the informal financial system is a wake-up call for banks to put in great efforts toward financial inclusion. Bank needs to take bold decisions and reach out to rural India with strategies and business models which are beyond the realm of conventional thinking. And next. Government and
Is it possible that you don't read it out?
Okay, sir.
You can just say point by point.
Okay. Government and RBI initiative for financial inclusion. Financial inclusion was featured in 2005, and RBI has advised.
Please don't go into the history. When the financial inclusion started, what does it mean? How is it? You just say what the Bank of Baroda has done.
Okay.
For the purpose of financial
data analysis and table first, for the null hypothesis, well, I had for the calculated chi-square value for two variables is opening no-frill accounts in Bank of Baroda and dependency of villages on informal sources has been shown, and calculated value is 0.428, which is less than. Which is less than from tabular value 3.84 and on 5% level of significance, then hypothesis is accepted. Then study reveals that opening no-frill accounts in Nagpura.
Preetu, just listen to me. Please do not tell us what is the value and what is not the value. You just tell us.
Interpretation is that opening a no-frill account has not helped the customer to avoiding assessing the informal sources to meet their financial needs. It proves that villages open a no-frill account has not given them confidence that whenever they unko jab bhi zarurat hogi in future mein financial needs ki wo bank ke paas jaake unki puri ho sakti hai. In second table, two variables, that is age of the customers and awareness about the financial services has shown, and according to calculated value, hypothesis is accepted, and the study reveals that analysis of the relation between age of the customer and awareness offered in the Nagpura are not related to each other, both are independent. It means that for getting to know about the new services launched in the village, it is the interest in the human being, not the age factor. Next slide is, in the third table, two variables, level of education and the saving habit among the customer has shown, and the calculated chi-square value is within the limit, so this hypothesis also is accepted.
You see, the basic premise of the financial inclusion is this: those who have been left out, those who are not in the mainstream, they should be brought in the mainstream of the financial inclusion. So if the person, whether literate or illiterate, whether they have already their accounts or no frill accounts or with the balance account, I think anybody having accounts in the banks, they are beyond the scope of the financial inclusion. If you have already your account in the bank, how I can survey you, whether educated or non-educated or with this income or this with this age, as a part of the financial inclusion? Financial inclusion simply means if there are 100 students are sitting here, out of them 20 are not at all being served by the banking system, they have to be included. And they should be the scope for the study for the bank financial inclusion. Not those who have already opened the accounts. But you have included those people also. So where is the financial inclusion? Are you getting my point?
Yes, sir.
Then, you see, putting these chi-square tests or putting these statistical tables, great, all are fine. But on whom you are applying it? You see, Jandhan Yojana mein advertisement kya aata hai? आपके घर में कोई बाई काम करती है, आपके घर में कोई धोबी आता है, कोई दूध वाला आता है, आप ये मोटिवेट करते हो उसको कि भाई आई हैव मोटिवेटेड 3 पीपल टू ओपन देयर बैंक अकाउंट. दैट इज व्हाट बेसिकली इज द फाइनेंशियल इंक्लूजन. मेरे अकाउंट में पैसा है कि नहीं है, उसका उससे ताल्लुक है कि नो, दैट्स नॉट द फाइनेंशियल इंक्लूजन. तो डिफरेंट फोकस हो गया ना बच्चे. चलिए थैंक यू.
Dignities on the dais of the dais, faculty members of IAS University and research scholars and dear students, my topic is financial globalization impact on the development of India. All person know what is globalization, so I am skipping this. My objective of this research paper is to analyze the factor contributing to financial globalization. And the second one is to evaluate the impact of factor on development of India. And my research methodology is descriptive plus analytical research because I have taken secondary data from World Bank indicators, IMF reports, newspapers, journals, articles and various reports by NITI Aayog. Financial globalization have two main aspects, free flow of capital, because I am talking only on economical globalization, so it have two main aspects, free flow of capital into of the domestic economy, and second one is high foreign participation in domestic financial system. And these two financial aspects can be measured by capital mobility and foreign participation. And these are the reforms and financial globalization have been seen from 1991, because from that era we have seen so many changes in Indian economy, which is devaluation. These are the main factors: devaluation, dismantling of this industrial licensing regime, abolition of MRTP Act, and the reduction of peak custom tariff. And these are this is the data I have taken, the external debt position, which is the indicating the rising position of India in the market position. Foreign direct investment is increasing by tenfold, and from 2004 to 2014-15, this is India is globalizing and increasing their investment. Next. Foreign trade is also increasing their good trade value, but it's in minus. So it is a negative point of Indian economy, and we try to reduce the foreign trade balance and increase our export in this manner. And the balance of payment, I have shown the capital current account, invisible and trade of balance, and balance of payment. These are very fluctuating in manner, and there is increasing trend in this era because in this time, because the inflation and other factors are working for negative balance of payment. And finally, I conclude that this is the first best solution, because for globalization, financial globalization, we have to take global supervision and micro macro economic regulation in the same fashion, that a healthy financial system is sustained in India. And second best is adopting by Modi government is making India concept is a positive factor and increasing factor for financial globalization. We have to take it seriously, and foreign investment is increasing at a fast pace, and it will move India in a developed country. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. See, our job is to point out certain basic defects. Say, for example, impact of financial globalization, impact on the development of India. It means financial globalization is an independent factor, right? And the impact on India is a dependent factor. So it all depends on Indian situation that how they can take the benefit of the financial globalization. Not that you are having that MITP is abolished, this is abolished. It's not like that. So you are putting cart before the horse or the horse before the cart. It's something like that. Anyway, now the next paper is Supriya Singhal, Initial Public Offering and Its Presence in Indian Capital Market. Is she present? Yes.
The topic of my presentation is Initial Public Offerings and Its Presence in the Indian Capital Market.
And please come to the conclusion
only. I will take only 3 minutes.
No, it will take 5 minutes. You see, IPOs have already been discussed by Dr. Ramesh.
Yes. So Professor B. Ramesh has already discussed the topic IPO very clearly and very nicely. So I'm skipping my first part, that is initial public offerings, which is why we should go for IPO. I'm skipping that one. Process of going public, I'm skipping that also, and the pros and cons of going public. So I'm skipping this one. I'm directly coming to the statistical part, that scenario of IPO in India. As we can see here that in 2010, around 36,360 crores were raised through IPO, whereas in 2014, it's only 1,091 crores, which shows a very drastic decline in the money raised through IPOs. Why it is so? There is a general phenomenon regarding IPOs is that IPOs only comes during the bull market, not the bear market. Because during the bull market, market sentiments improves, which makes investors more attractive towards the market, and they become greedy because they see the positive vibes coming from the market. And that is the reason in the 2010, 36,000 crores were raised, and whereas in 2014, it is only 1,091 crores. But now in 2015, in the first mid of 2015, 4,950 crores had already raised in 6 months. And it is going to be raised in the near future because now market is again in the bull market, bull phase. Next slide. Next slide shows financial advice success and failures of IPOs in India. I would like to ask a question that, do you feel so that IPO is a risky investment? I feel like according to the surveys, it is the most riskiest investment for the investor. Why? Because it is betting on a company which is still in the testing waters. Means the company which are not in the share market is now coming in the market for the first time. So we don't have any kind of financial information of the company, and also we don't have any access to the management meeting over there. So it is a kind of a riskiest investment, and that is, but because of this only, because of in spite of these reasons, the success of the IPOs are more rather than the failures. These are the top gainers. I'm not talking about the companies. The
success is more than failure, it means.
So means IPOs, the companies which are raising the IPOs are getting profit rather than they are losing. The investors are more attractive towards the IPOs. So these are the top gainers and top losers of 2014. So the conclusion is that it is an attractive and authentic source of money raising for capital seeking companies, which helps the companies to expand their business, access to capital in future, mergers and acquisition, etc. Thank you.
Yes, can we keep
this industry in India, special reference to life insurance sector. Indian life insurance sector is earning a remarkable growth. It is one of the sectors that is observing good growth in the scenario where nearly all the industries in the world are trying hard for survival due to rapid economic changes. The changing trends play a great role and support Indian insurance industry to cope with the varying economic environment. On the other hand, opening up of insurance sector for private insurers is another great achievement, which not only broke the monopoly of LIC, but also throws a tough competition in the insurance market, which results into innovation in products, pricing, distribution channels and marketing in the industry. Thus, the sector has a great potential to grow. With this, the study concludes that by adopting appropriate strategy, Indian insurance industry will certainly become the new insurance giant in future. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, Dr. Mani Bhatia.
I just come to the conclusion part. The increased competition within the investment banking sector, coupled with the deregulation of financial service industry, has also led to the increased activities and need to devise, design and innovate new products, develop better processes and implement more effective solutions for increasingly complex financial problems. Thank you.
Thank you.
As you know, my topic is a study of financial inclusion in India. It's implementing agencies and stakeholders in Rajasthan. I'll just come directly to the findings and conclusion. We have taken a sample size of 100 respondents, and out of them, 43 were females and 57 were males. And when we were talking to our respondents,
so again male dominated.
Yes, sir?
Again, male dominated.
Yes. But when we asked them a question, how many were having a bank account and such that, so we saw that out of 43 females, 34 of them were having access to a bank account. And out of 57 males, 31 of them were having access to bank accounts. So in that sense, we can say there were more females who had access to bank account. And then we had another very interesting question in that questionnaire about the age group, in which we saw that now the coming of youth between 15 to 20 years, they had access to bank account and they were willing to come under all this so that they can be economically connected to our banking system and they can facilitate the various facilities given by the government like insurance and various credit facilities. Next slide, please. Okay, so now out of our 100 respondents, only 65% of them had access to bank account. Not all of them were aware about the no frills account and the government opening up and taking various initiatives to include them economically in our banking system. Conclusion. So in the conclusion, we find out that the awareness is really important. Not only we talk about the group awareness, but at the time of opening up the bank account, we need to tell the individuals about the various benefits they would have access to while they'll operate their banking account. Like they can have insurance, they can have credit facilities, and they would benefit a lot. They can now move out of those money lenders and they can be actually get credit and they can have a very gainful experience with that. Next one. Suggestions. So in suggestions, we say that though the individuals are moving towards these no frills account and various Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana and Bhavasya Yojana, but still they're not finding it to be beneficial. They are still afraid to go for this banking system as they quite found that there are many costs related to it. So the awareness is still lagging behind. We need to make aware them. Thank you.
Thank you. Now the next paper is Ms. Mitali Gupta and Shweta Gupta, IFRS in India, Problems and Challenges. Is she present? No? Okay. Now I move on to next one. Dr. Monty Kanodia, IIS University, Financial Inclusion, Problems and Prospects. Is she present here? Okay. I'll move to next one. C.A. Priya Jain, IIS University again, Financial Reporting and Corporate Governance in Banking Sector, Problems and Remedies. Now she is the last presenter. If anybody is present here and I have missed them, kindly please report it to me.
Namaskar everyone. I am presenting a paper on financial reporting and corporate governance in banking sector, problems and remedies. Sir, I am just defining the definition in simple words.
And we don't need any definition.
Okay. Then I am going to
go to the main points of your study.
So there were certain scams which arose in banking sector, due to which introduction of these corporate governance and financial reporting was made. There was a huge scam which was seen in Dena Bank, which encouraged corporate governance and financial reporting. In that case, the manager, Mr. Preetham, and certain other persons took loan using forged documents. And CBI revealed the scam of around ₹220 crore. Due to these certain other scams, need of corporate governance and financial reporting in banking sector arose. Now, for better presentation of my viewpoint, a secondary data is being incorporated, where a survey was conducted by a magazine over 118 customers. Various questions were asked from customers on their viewpoint regarding banking system prevailing in India. The questions were like, transparency in financial reporting in banking sector is poor or not? 44.9% agreed that financial reporting was poor. Another question was that if there are ethical issues of governance and financial reporting in banking industry after consolidation, 62.7% agreed the same. One of the major questions was that whether ethical issues are there due to merger and acquisition, 42.4% agreed to the viewpoint. Another question was that financial reporting is a responsibility of directors, but the same is being performed by accountant and verified by internal auditors. 57.6% were in this favor. At the end, I would like to conclude that banking sector is a major source of revenue of every country. They should focus on transparency. If they failed to perform their duty, then punishment should be properly designed. Government should also try to make certain provisions for more transparency of banks. Otherwise, these scams in bank will continue, leading to heavy losses to the customers. Thank you.
Thank you for the questions. Or I can take the questions. So now the house is open for discussion.
I just wanted to ask that what was the criteria which she decided to determine the success and failure of the IPOs? So probably she only could tell that.
No, she's fine.
I think Professor Ramya can.
Sorry.
But during my presentation, I did not go through the details of the entire data what I have done in terms of research. The success or failure of the IPOs are seen in terms of the pricing. What is exactly done in the IPOs is the pricing, because these are the companies which were not existing earlier in terms of its in public domain. They are not part of the stock exchange data. They are not part of the regulation of SEBI. So first time they have come and they got the nod from the SEBI, not from the stock exchange. They have gone for public issue. But the investors, whoever are investing in such IPOs, they have only a private data for confirmation in terms of assessment of their potential. Fine. So otherwise there is no authentic data of their profits, what they are earning. So the investors are taking risk. Now there are two, three issues which are involved. One, what is the pricing, what they are doing in terms of the premium, what they are charging. Obviously every company which is a profit earning company has to come with a premium. Now the question is, the investors would not know in terms of the potential, what it was in the past and what is likely to be in the future. So it's only a furor that is created at the time if the market is going with some lot of activity. And as she mentioned, normally most of the IPOs are issued during the boom period. But that's for right, because nobody, no company would like to come with a public issue when the market is down. That is a fact. It's only when the market is in a healthy condition, everybody wants to come because they find timing is better option. So apart from that, if a company comes out with a premium and you need to make an assessment, and we don't have earlier the kind of IPO grading, but at least now we have some kind of grading system in place. So investors have to depend on this kind of grading and also use their own judgment before making an investment decision. So there is nothing like somebody gives you a kind of tip But you should not believe in that kind of data, and you have to be your own judge. That is what ultimately we believe in. Now the success of any of IPOs after all these kind of precautions that are taken is in terms of what are the price at which the company has finalized its allotment and then listed on the exchange. Then what is its post performance? But in my research study, what I have referred is that short-term performance and long-term performance. And short-term performance in the sense that within a period of 3 months after listing. Because initially, if there is any public issue which is oversubscribed by number of times, so initially there will be a hype where the initial listing price would be much higher than the price at which the company made the allotment. So obviously there is a premium in the market. So people who are attracted to book the profit, so they would not mind hesitating to sell it, so that in no time they make quick buck of it. So as a result, there is again a market pressure in terms of supply side, and the price comes down. But then how long that sustainability of the market price over and above the price at which the IPOs are sold. So that is the success that has to be seen. And how long that market price would continue to be higher than the price at which it is sold. And if in the initial period of 1 month or 1 week or 15 days, if the price, market price is higher, and subsequently if it falls lower than the market price. For example, the classic example is the MVP Infrastructure Limited, which has gone for publication in the last month, August, September. And the price was fixed at 65 rupees, listed at 67, and then within 1 week the price has fallen to 38 rupees. So now this is what you call success or failure. It is definitely a failure. So sustainability of the market price over and above the price at which the company sells to public is the test of it. And now you have to be aware, keep in mind, because the Indian stock market is not a perfect market. Remember that. There are a lot of imperfections. So again, you cannot conclude the judgment that this is a failure within 3 months or within 6 months. You need to wait at least for 1 year to give the opportunity for the company to come out with its first public results after completing 1 year of its performance. Then automatically the market price again gets changed. So even after 1 year of its public results, financial results announced, if the market price continues to be lower than initial price, so that means the investors have lost. So that is considered a failure. So in my study, what I have done, short term I have taken 6 months, long term I have taken 3 years. And in the short term, all the 150 companies, the case that I have taken, which got listed in the NSE, many of them were the failures. Failures in the sense that the market price was lower than the issue price. And in the long run, the loss that is sustained by investors is slightly lower than the short term. So that is how one has to look at
it.
Yeah, that is what Chairman has pointed out. And maybe that's why she was instantly reacting to that.
It happens. When somebody comes on the public podium, then who loses confidence? It takes some time to gain confidence. Any other question, please? Any other questions? So you can use the chairman's remarks time also. I don't mind, because I want to provoke as many questions as possible from the audience. Any questions, please? Do you want to say something? So you permit me to...
Yeah, no, you're the chairman.
No, I'll go there.
Yeah.
Friends, let me tell you right at the outset that it was really a wonderful experience for me. As I told you in the beginning, those who are known to be the notorious people, like me, so people make him or her a chair of the session, so he has to follow all the protocols and all the
the etiquette and doesn't have to speak like that. I thought that the discussion would continue for long, and I would be happy to sacrifice the chairman's time, which is normally done. But it didn't happen. I thought that many questions will come. And I tell you, my personal observation is, there were so many issues in so many papers that many questions could have been asked. Provided you have listened to those papers carefully. Anyway, as they so be. Now, let me just give you in brief my own remarks. I'll start with the financial inclusion. I think my phone is disturbed. Sir, can I call you after half an hour? Achha, I'm okay. Let me tell you something about the financial inclusion. What exactly this financial, how this exactly this financial inclusion started? We have been using the term in commerce and economics, unbanked areas, banking backward areas. Let me tell you why this nationalization of banks was done in 1969. Simply because of the reason that there was a social purpose. And what was that social purpose? That to unshackle the amount of capital which was controlled by very few. So not only from the point of view of investment, but also from the point of view of the participation in the financial system of the country. But that could not be achieved, say, from 1969 to 2013 or 2012. And that is why we decided in terms of the financial inclusion the same way as we did in terms of Garibi Hatao. That was the basis for the financial inclusion. But then again, the best part of the financial inclusion was supposed to be the self-help groups, as some paper presenter has mentioned. In fact, the self-help group experience also failed. If you remember Professor Mohammed Yunus of Bangladesh, who created a bank and who created the concept of these self-help groups and this microfinance. That microfinance was more successfully working in Bangladesh as compared to India. So that was the reason why this financial inclusion was started. And let me tell you, if I correctly remember from the Upanishad, there is one very important shloka there. Isha Vashyamidam Yat Kincha Jagatyam Jagat Tiena Tyaktena Bhunjitha Magradha Kasya Suddhanam. This money is not mine, this wealth is not mine. This wealth belongs to everybody. The day we left this canoe, the day we started avoiding this kind of a principle, the whole concentration of economic power started. If we follow that shloka now these days in terms of the Upanishad, I think there is no requirement for the financial inclusion, it is automatically there. Same is the question of the trusteeship theory of Gandhi. If you study Gandhism, you will find a trusteeship theory that whatever the money you are earning, the people are consuming it in a different way. And one thing I'll tell you about the crowd investment. If you call it a crowd investment, then if I can remember on the basis of my memory, the first crowding investment was when Jamshedji Kursedji Tata established the Tata Steel and Iron Company 100 years back. He thought that if I issue the shares, Indians are poor, so I'll not be getting any capital. But to his chagrin, the moment he issued the share capital of the TISCO, maximum contributors were from India. If that can be taken as a crowdfunding in a crude sense, than it was the first crowdfunding in India. Let me tell you something about these IPOs. I think lesser said the better said. The Achilles heel, I'm sorry, I should not use that word Achilles heel, the killing ground, I should say. Because Achilles was the Roman warrior. His heel was vulnerable to attack. So somebody told him that if you want to defeat Achilles, then you'll have to hit his heel. That's why it is known as the Achilles heel. The Achilles heel of the Indian capital market is taking the investors for a ride. I have also noted those points, as Professor Ramesh has very rightly said. Whole thing depends on the pricing of the issue. How the shares are being priced. SEBI has become so liberal because in our country, that is also applicable to the corporate governance and corporate social responsibility. Somebody has quoted Punjab National Bank has followed 44 out of 50 and some other banks followed 41 out of 50. It's not like that. Main problem is that we want everything in writing. So we are technically ticking. Done ticked, not ticked. But we are not actually doing it. That is the main problem in the corporate social responsibility as well as the corporate governance also. So what has happened in the IPO, as I intervened in between also, as Professor Ramesh has very rightly said, and the question was also asked by the lady that how you will decide the success and the failure of the IPO. The question is that it all depends on the price. The moment IPO is closed, grey market begins to operate. And as Professor Ramesh has rightly said, we call them the punters. The punters get their money back and they move out and finally the prices go down. But the question is, how the price is being allowed to be set so high? Either through the book building process or by the qualified institutional buyers and institutional investors and all that. The simple reason is, the responsible is the SEBI. What SEBI has done over the period of time? If you go to the Companies Act and prospectors and the kind of prospectors, red herring prospectors, this prospectors and that prospectors. In the beginning, when the SEBI was created in 1992, the disclaimer clause was just two lines. Now the disclaimer clause runs into 15 to 20 lines. So I normally taunt on them in a way. It is just like a statutory warning on the cigarette packet that smoking is injurious to health and the cigarette packets are being sold in the market. Same thing SEBI is doing. Everything comes on the investor. The regulating agencies are not taking any responsibility either in terms of the fly-by-night operators or in terms of the veracity of the company or in terms of the statements of the company, whether they are correct or not, whether they are authentic or not. As Professor Ramesh has rightly said, whatever they have given in the prospectus, that is up to you to decide whether it is correct or not. Because there are provisions in the Companies Act that if you misrepresent, you will be sued. But the question is, the day you will misrepresent, the day you will sue, the day you will get the remedy of it, 5 years, 10 years down the line will be over and you will lose your money. Are you aware of the fact 9,000 companies are of no existence now, those which raised money from the market from 92 to 2010. It means over a period of 30 years, 90,000 companies are absolutely non-existent. If you have got those shares, keep them in your drawer, that you can say that I am the shareholders of this company, but in fact they are non-existent. So that is the problem. The regulating agencies are absolutely toothless. They are not in a position to control them. That's why I was mentioning, it is the pricing system that is very important so far as the success and failure of this concern. Just little things about the corporate governance and the corporate social responsibility. What basically you will call that corporate governance in one organization is better or in any other organization is worse? As I told you in the beginning, for everything on the earth, we come out with the legislation. For everything on the earth. Came the concept corporate social responsibility, then we made a provision in the company's law that it has to be done. Came the question of corporate governance, we made out a provision in the company's act that this is to be done. Legal provisions do not ensure any kind of the governance anywhere. It comes from within. Then independent directors you appointed. Are you aware that Satyam Computers got the best awards for the corporate governance for many years? But that was the company, Ramalingam Raju or the gentleman, they annihilated the entire company. So the question is that it cannot be enforced by law. It has to be enforced by the traditions, by the systems. As I told you in the beginning, that the shloka which I have quoted in the Upanishad. Then, the last point which I would like to make here is, so far as this corporate governance is concerned, independent directors were appointed. There are clear-cut responsibility of the independent directors that they will report this, they will report this. If it doesn't happen, they will report this. Nobody reports. You see, the stake of the independent directors becomes very high once one is appointed as an independent director. So it's a big failure on the part of the corporate governance. Take the example of Enron. Somebody has mentioned about the forensic account. Let me tell you one simple sentence about the forensic accounting in India is, friends, the issue of forensic becomes relevant after the commitment of the crime, not before the commitment of the crime. So you see, the special fraud operations and the special group of CBI and all that, those people come to us, sir, tell us how to do it, because they don't have the wherewithal how to deal with this issue. So now the question is that if you do not create the practice and traditions and the systems which can ensure the kind of things which you really want to, nothing can be done. So friends, let me be not very long, but in the last, I'll again thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. I really enjoyed the chairmanship of this session, and I also thank all the presenters, and I also thank my fellow colleagues, Professor Ramesh and Professor Giridharan, who has gone earlier. So thank you very much. Thank you.